Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Artificial Jelly by Dustin Graham, narrated by Traci Odom. Prologue. I am ashamed. Ashamed of how many times I allowed myself to just follow the instinct, the routine, especially when the routine included dying. But I did. I followed that instinct for an eternity before I knew what eternity meant. I've died dozens of times, hundreds. I guess I'm thankful for those deaths now. Thankful even of Red Thorn. I wasn't back then. I hated her. I would have done anything to get back at her. Beating her the few times I could manage it was all I had, and it never lasted. She would just return, ready to try all over again. Red Thorn's blade was the only certainty in such a small little world. It was all there was until I finally found the courage to seek my own. Chapter 1. Cycle After Cycle.
"Good morning, Bugbear," I exclaimed excitedly. "What are you up to this cycle?"
The creature didn't respond, but that was to be expected. Bugbear never responded, never said anything at all. Even so, I felt like we'd developed a real connection. The beastly creature looked at me, snorted, then continued prowling its way down the desecrated halls of our home.
He was in a good mood.
"Me too," I said self-assuredly.
I wasn't certain Bugbear could understand my speech. I was, after all, a jellyfae. He was a large beastly creature who wore little more than a loincloth and a leather subligaculum, while dragging a mace along the floor. That was the way he'd always been. I hoped he could understand me. But even if he couldn't, we were friends anyway. I knew because he always looked at me. Every day he acknowledged me. Most of the others didn't so much as glance in my direction. I floated along behind him, curious about why he was always dragging that morning star around and growling at everything. He was always sniffing and looking down the halls as if expecting someone to hunt him or hurt him. I knew he was a guard. That much was easy enough to tell. But no one ever came here. No one ever had, as far back as I could remember. Yet every cycle he moved through, he kept up his guard, always vigilant. Did he know something I didn't? Maybe they all did. He was the only one who ever noticed me directly, though. I didn't know why I was this way, why I was different from everyone else. But what could I do?
"Oh, you did that last cycle," I told Bugbear sourly.
"Don't you think that area of the hall has been really well patrolled already?"
"Oh, I know. Let's go this way."
I floated a little further down the hall, and Bugbear's eyes followed me as if he was tempted, as if he just might try to see what was down this hall. I already knew, of course. I'd long since explored the entirety of Dungeon Home, but as far back as I could remember, Bugbear had never left his circuit. That didn't change now, of course. He turned and continued trudging down the same circle he always walked. Like clockwork, he'd reach the end of the hall and come back, wary, sniffing the air and staring at me occasionally. The others didn't even go that far, content to just walk their circles, completely oblivious to my existence. So most days I stayed next to him, jabbering his ears off with my echoes, in the hopes that one day he'd try to talk back instead of just growling at me randomly. Bugbear's growls were the only random thing in all of Dungeon Home. Everything else was the same as the cycle before. Sometimes I wondered if I used to be like that. Did I once wander in endless circles like Bugbear did, long before my earliest memories? I like to think so. Maybe once I wasn't so weird. Maybe I was normal once, like Bugbear, the other creatures that roamed the halls, and Mama Boss Bear. Not anymore, though. Maybe not ever. There were no others in Dungeon Home like me, though there were several different Bugbears who looked almost identical to Bugbear. None of them were him, though. He was special, if only a little. He paid attention to me every now and then. He was different,
like me. I was Gell, the Jellyfae, and I was lonely. I shook myself, my shocker waving in the air as I floated up a little higher to swirl around the warm, candlelit chandelier. The fire of the candles felt good to the touch, and I could hide within them if I wanted to. It was warm and cozy, one of my favorite spots. I often hid behind the fires as part of my instinct, too, but right now I was just enjoying the warmth. I curled up around the light fixture and waited there for almost a whole cycle before it grew a little too hot. The next time Bugbear walked by, I floated back down slowly. He turned toward me, staring with his big eyes and snorting hot air with his big nose as he noticed me again.
Well, it was good to see you, Bugbear. I'm going to go see Mama Boss Bear. Talk to you later.
He snorted at me, which I took to mean yes. I lit myself up bright yellow, which he always seemed to enjoy, before floating away down the halls of Dungeon Home. Dungeon Home was just that. Home. The whole world, from the great open at the top with the strange green spiky floor and the hole in the sky where the stone ceiling should be, down to the big boss room where Mama Boss Bear sat on her throne looking bored all day. I slowly made my way through the many long hallways of stone. The blue torches burning with flame weren't nearly as warm as the chandelier, but that was probably why they didn't hurt me. I often couldn't resist camouflaging myself to disappear into them. I could sit right behind the candle flame and be completely invisible if I wanted, though I'd long since stopped trying to figure out what it was my instincts told me to hide from. It took effort sometimes to make myself go where I normally wouldn't. It was a little scary and a lot exciting. I felt like I was breaking the rules, though even that had become dull at some point. Nowadays, when I let my mind wander, I'd find myself automatically drifting back into those old patterns. Following the instinct that guided the cycle was easy. I didn't feel like it today, though. Today was a day for rule-breaking. Maybe I'd finally get up the guts to venture out into the big open on the top floor today. Probably not. That big blue ceiling was so far away, felt like I might just fall into it. Worse, every time I thought of venturing out, the scandalous feeling of breaking the rules went from mild excitement to gut-wrenching fear. More than once, I'd been determined to leave through that otherworldly tunnel where the colors changed and the ceiling fell away, only to turn back upon the realization that there were some rules I shouldn't break. I might be different from the rest, but I belonged in Dungeon Home, with my family. I skipped my usual routine and floated through a metal door when Skeleton and Skeledog opened it. I'd long since timed everyone's path, and when they opened the doors, so slipping through them was easy. It had been so exciting when I discovered I could use doors whenever others opened them. I didn't have any hands like everyone else, just my shocker. But that wasn't so bad. Skeledog couldn't open them either, with his paws always on the ground. And none of them could float or fly. Most important of all, none of them could break the rules. I reached Mama Boss Bear's throne room with a lilt in my float. I bounced around happily, flitting between the bones that always littered Mama's cave floor. I'd wondered if those bones might become people like Skeleton if I arranged them properly, but when I'd actually done it, they never had. Instead, at the turnover time, they'd always reset to where they were before, scattered all over. It was incredibly frustrating at the time. "Hiya, Mama Boss Bear," I said exuberantly, glowing my usual blue shade as I entered the throne room. "Anything new?" Mama Boss Bear didn't acknowledge me, content instead to merely stare at the door like she always did. I wasn't surprised. Mama Boss Bear was the biggest member of my family. She was huge, at least 20 of me. Maybe 50, though that wasn't saying a lot. I was the smallest after all. I fought down the brief surge of envy at Boss Bear's big arms and legs. She could open any door in Dungeon Home with arms so big, but she never even used them. It was why I came here sometimes, though my instinct brought me here occasionally as well. I wanted to make her move. All the others at least got to walk around and see their world.
Even I, strange as I was, had the freedom to see our whole world. Why, then, did Mama Boss Bear have to sit still in her dreary throne room forever? She was the boss, after all, right? Shouldn't she get to go wherever she wanted? She never did, though. I trembled a little, but shook myself to ward off the fear. The fear that... maybe she never would. In the dark corners of my mind, the place where I hid my deepest rule-breaking, I hated the thought that ran through me unbidden. Is this really all there is? The answers might lie beyond the great open at the top of Dungeon Home, with the green floor and the too high ceiling. And maybe one day I would be brave enough to venture out. For now, though, I was wasting time. Maybe today Crumbled Skeleton would wake up after I arranged his bones for what must have been the 1,000th cycle. All of a sudden, the torchlights changed color. The torchlights that I danced in and hid within. The torchlights, blue for as long as I could remember. Blue for cycle after cycle. Blue. Blue. Always blue. They changed. They became the brightest red I had ever seen. Then, while I was already reeling from my stupor at the abrupt change of my entire world, a sudden whirlwind buffeted me into the far wall. Mama Boss Bear stood. She roared. And I trembled, sore afraid. Chapter 2. Raiding Party. I shook in the corner, so terrified that I didn't know what to do. In all my life, Mama Boss Bear had never stood from her throne. The candles had always been blue. Why? What happened? What had I done? I thought I'd wanted something to happen, but this was too much, too fast. I found myself moving, but it took some time for me to come to the realization that I was following my old route, following the instinct. I fell into it gleefully, seeking comfort in the normalcy. I thought I was ready for something new, but Mama Boss Bear's roar had shown me how stupid that was. I was happy here, with my family, with Bugbear and Skeledog and Skeleton and Mama Boss Bear and the others. I didn't need change. But change came. Leaving the room, I found that my entire world had changed from its comforting, muted blue to a bright red of burning fire. Every torch in the dungeon was brightly lit. What had happened? What had changed? Would I get to find out? Why had Dungeon Home lit up like this? It had never done so before. Once the initial shock wore off, I found myself a little excited. Not so much so that I was ready to ignore the instinct yet, but enough that I wanted to. Time passed slowly, and I flew by many of the other denizens of Dungeon Home, skeletons and bugbears who weren't my skeleton and bugbear, but were from other routes deeper in or further towards the top. I even saw Old Ghoul, who occasionally wandered the fourth floor. Of course, she wasn't there right now. She decided to go to the fifth floor's oval chamber for some reason. Was she... could it be that she was breaking the rules, too? Somehow, I didn't think so. I followed my route as soon as I got back to it, taking comfort in the serenity of it. The fire in the wall sconces was red now. Red instead of blue. That was no big deal. That wasn't scary. I turned red all the time if it struck my fancy. So I hadn't known the fire could change color, too. It wasn't anything to be so terrified about. My shocker wouldn't stop shaking in the air, though, twitching at the new events as things cascaded out of control. Why? What had I done? Was it even my doing at all? Inevitably, my instinctual route took me back to the top floor of Dungeon Home, and there I found the source of the disturbance. Invaders. I flitted from candlelight to candlelight, making sure to blend in with the now red fires instead of the gentle blue, as I saw the strange creatures enter, presumably from outside the great hole where the ceiling fell up. I'd always called it the Great Open. None of them noticed me as I entered the large chamber and immediately flitted to one of the torches that hung from the walls.
It's a low-level dungeon, all right. Barely worth our time. Monsters have a long aggro range, though. Kited D's all the way from the third floor,
said one of the two-legged creatures.
Don't understand why this place was so hard to get to. Maybe it gets tougher deeper down, but... yeah, like I said, pretty weak.
They had no fur like the bugbears, and no bones like the skeletons. Instead, four of the five of them were covered by a strange, pale pink... shell? It was like Mama Boss Bear's lips, but all over their bodies. Not at all like my membrane. Each of them was covered in that shell. Skin, I realized. Their skin was covered in clothes instead of fur. I liked that. Clothes were at least somewhat familiar. Most of all, though, they were speaking. They were communicating with one another, in the same language as all of my thoughts. I could understand them. Oh my God. I wanted to jump right out and speak to them, but something held me back. Some gut feeling. Maybe it was the instinct. Something was wrong here, though. Why was Mama Boss Bear so mad? And why had Dungeon Home turned so bright and angry when these people came in? And what were those strange lumps lying on the ground? I was a good 15 feet away, but the room was brighter than ever. The five creatures stood near the far end of the room towards one of the exits that weren't part of my instinct. I'd visited, of course, but there were only more bugbears down there with a dead end about three floors down, and none of them reacted to me like Bugbear did.
Might be a good farming place for newbies, said the shortest pink creature.
I immediately decided to call her Red Hood because, well, she wore a red hood. She looked friendly and kind, but the wicked-looking daggers in her belt spelled danger for me.
Strange, though, the girl continued. Did you notice? They all had names. Like, they were definitely NPCs. They reacted like regular mobs, but each of them had a title. Is that weird to anyone?
NPCs? I thought, confused. I didn't recognize that term.
Mobs? Just a quirk of the dungeon? Programmers having fun?
Asked the short, wide one with hair on his face. I liked him the most. He reminded me of Bugbear. I immediately christened him Beardy Wall because his face looked like a wall of beard.
Seems unlikely. Most of the dungeons are dynamically generated, though not all of them. This place is a long way out, though, said the green-skinned one with the white robes. We could power-level newbies here if we built a guild hall and set it as a spawn point, but it'd be tough otherwise.
Power-level? Newbies?
I understood the words, but their meaning was lost on me. I was enthralled anyway, though. Unlike my family, these creatures could talk. They could make noise more than growls and grunts. They were like me. I didn't dare leave my candles, though. Hard instinct and a sensation of rules that should never be broken had overpowered my usual fearlessness. I hid, but my excitement was rising by the moment.
We barely even have a guild. This place is weak up top, but we don't know what's below yet. Don't get ahead of yourself, Germ, Red Hood said with a grin.
They walked right by me, none of them noticing as I watched them make their way further into the heart of Dungeon Home. When they had gone down the stairs to the second level, I felt the instinct pushing me to follow them. I dimmed my glow entirely and blended in with the walls, but I didn't follow just yet. I broke the rules. Something about those strange lumps on the floor was familiar. Daunting. I floated closer, confused as I realized what they were. Bodies. My family. The lumps were my family, but they were arranged in ways that they never had been before. Oh God, were they breaking the rules too? I shook with anticipation as I hovered over them. Seven bugbears. All family, of course, though some were so far away from the root of my instinct that I'd only recently gotten up the courage to name them. Buggy, Barrington, Overbear, Butterbear, Busterbear, Bugrimus, and of course, Bugbear. The one who noticed me and growled at me like he might understand. They were all here, and none of them were on their route. They were breaking the rules.
They were like me.
Something was wrong, though. They weren't moving. Also, their name tags were gone. The labels that had appeared above them when I'd named them all those cycles ago had disappeared. They weren't right. Parts of them were missing. Red ooze of some sort was leaking out of the limbs and gashes where their bodies were changed, damaged. Their fur looked strange, wet. Wet as if they jumped into the pool at the bottom of Dungeon Home. But not the same.
Bugbear? I asked, hoping to hear him growl.
I hovered down close to get a better look. Bugbear's eyes were wide open, but I felt like there was nothing behind them, even less than normal. The fear that had overwhelmed me when Mama Boss Bear roared in her throne room far below wasn't like this. This was a creeping feeling, a dread, cold and painful. My membrane spasmed and I suddenly realized I was losing control of my color. That had never happened before. My bugbears, my family, they were broken. The invaders had broken them. They must not have known how to properly talk to my family, though. That must have been it, because as far as I knew, they had no reason to attack my family. So there must have just been a huge misunderstanding. Well, I could fix that. I wandered across the room. Bugbear's club was there. I picked it up with my shocker and brought it back over to him. I tried to put it back in his hand where it always was, but his hand was severed just below his shoulder. A big rent in his side showed where something sharp like the stalactites must have cut through the arm and continued on into his fur-covered ribs. It took a few minutes of searching to find the limb. It was lying underneath Overbear, and it took all my might to tug it out. It was still leaking the strange red ooze. The stuff clung to my shocker. I hated it. Blood, I thought. Another word that I knew but had no memory of learning. Just information planted in my head. That's what my family is made out of. Well, the bugbears anyway. Skeleton and his kin, as well as Skeledog, don't have blood. But Bugbear does. Why did they spill it everywhere? I dragged Bugbear's arm across the room. It was heavy, heavier than the club. I put it where it belonged, but pushing the lower arm into his shoulder just made more of the red blood ooze out. It flopped there, lifeless, but all the parts were in the right place. I couldn't put the blood back, but he didn't look damaged beyond that.
Bugbear? Could you
growl at me like you always do? I pleaded. Bugbear didn't respond. None of them did.
Buggy?
Buster Bear?
A hollowness seeped into my body that I didn't understand. A numbness. My color became a deep, dismal blue. I stroked Bugbear's cheek, but he didn't growl, didn't do anything.
Why? Why would they do that? I thought they were like me, so why? I would never do that to Bugbear and the rest of my family, no matter how different I was. Had they broken the rules so far that they just lived to break everything? I racked my brains, racing to find an explanation.
What if they break me like this, too? I trembled. The instinct was becoming more insistent. It wanted me to follow them. But those creatures, they were like me, and I broke the rules. I stopped following the instinct. If I kept doing that, would I become like them? Would I go into others' homes and break their families?
Instinct, I'm sorry. I won't break the rules again, I promised. Prayed.
But even speaking was against the instinct, so I stopped that.
So could you please bring my family back?
As if my prayer was being answered in the cruelest way, the bodies of my family suddenly began to stir. They weren't waking up, though. Instead, they were fading,
becoming transparent.
No, don't go away. Don't take them away. I can still fix them.
Were they becoming invisible like I could? Why were they disappearing? Was it because I spoke?
I'll follow the instinct. I promise I'll do better. So please, don't take my family away, I thought furiously.
As far as I knew, thinking wasn't against the instinct. It wasn't breaking any rules. My thoughts went unheeded, though, and in far too short a time, all of my family had vanished. I pushed my shocker where their bodies had been, but there was nothing there. They were gone. They were gone. They'd left me.
No! No! Bugbear? What? Why? What is happening?
I screamed desperately, unable to hold back my horror. I flitted around the room frantically, trying to find them.
Did they go into the ground? Could they have hidden in the torches like I did?
All this time I'd spent desperately wanting something new to happen. Not like this. This wasn't what I wanted. All the joy I'd had in life, all the happiness I'd felt, the exultant pride in breaking the rules and being so different. The arrogance from feeling better than my family because I could defy the instinct. It all evaporated, just like their bodies. Please, I moaned on the floor. Please, come back. They didn't. Hours passed, or moments that felt like hours. I floated to the floor. I wanted to weep, but I didn't know what that was. I didn't know why I knew these things. Why those creatures spoke in the words that my mind knew when my family had never said anything I could understand. But I knew then that I had to do my very best to never break the instinct again. This was punishment. This was what came from breaking the rules. I'd felt so wrong about it when I'd first started. But breaking the rules had been so much more interesting than following the same path. Those monsters. My mind supplied names like orc, human, dwarf, and drow, but I threw them away. I didn't want this knowledge. Not if it led to becoming like them. They'd ignored their instinct. They'd ignored it and ignored it and ignored it until they did whatever they wanted, and what they wanted to do was break things. I would not be like them. Fortunately, for once, my instinct aligned almost perfectly with what I wanted to do. Followed them closely. The only problem was that the instinct insisted that I hide. I didn't want to hide. I wanted to strike. I wanted to use my shocker and make them pay. These people, these creatures, they were what I'd been waiting for. This anger. This foreign toxic feeling flooding through my membrane. Maybe if I followed the instinct, I would get to use it. I blended into the walls and followed the creatures. My shocker buzzed with electricity. I didn't have a heart, but if I did, it would be racing. Suddenly, I heard Mama Boss Bear roar again. I felt happy. She would take care of them. Mama was huge, and I wanted to see her break them. I followed the instinct, but I followed it fast. Chapter 3. Follow the Instinct. I raced through the tunnels, unnerved by the well-lit area. Until today, the light from the torches that lined almost every hallway had always been a muted blue. Now the tunnels were bright, illuminating the stalactites and stalagmites that littered the ceiling and floor. The red flame cast eerie shadows that somehow made dungeon homes seem foreboding and frightening, where before it had been peaceful and calm. I floated into the stairwell on the third floor. The great steps had always been beautiful to me, highlighted in their blue torchlights. Now they were majestic. The floors and walls were marble on the lower levels, even and straight where above they were barren caves. The stairs led down to the fourth floor, the royal crypt, where Ghoul usually resided. Lying crumpled on the ancient steps, disrupting the spiderwebs that had lingered there longer than my memories, were the bones of Skeleton and Skeledog. I resisted the urge to go to them. That went against the instinct. My color became a deep blue-violet, sadness radiating through with burning red anger beneath it. What had Skeleton and Skeledog ever done to deserve being made inert like crumbling bones? I didn't wait to see if they would disappear, holding in my emotions. The instinct had always been there for me. It wouldn't fail me now, and I didn't think I could handle watching more of my family evaporate into the air. Could it be that the rest of my family felt that way about me whenever I went invisible? No, surely not. They never worried. It was the invaders that had changed them. Besides, I hardly ever camouflaged myself fully, preferring to glow with the colors of whatever emotion I was feeling, most often yellow joy. I passed by the chamber Ghoul inhabited, but it was empty of everything except the treasure chest she kept in there. That was opened and emptied of whatever it had once contained. I continued down to the oval chamber where I'd seen her go when I'd been rushing to the top of Dungeon Home. That was where I caught up to them. All five of the creatures were arrayed around Ghoul in a lopsided circle. I'd initially considered Beardywall my favorite and had named him in my head before I realized he'd hurt my family. Now I wished I'd given the monster a more sinister name as I watched him bash his shield into Ghoul's face. Behind him stood the only one of the creatures whose covering wasn't that pink, malleable shell. Instead, his skin? Yes, skin, was greenish, and he had fangs that looked dangerous like Mama Boss Bear's, though not nearly as big. The first thing to come to mind was Greentooth. He wore long white robes and held a staff, which he kept using to hurl waves of sparkling green light at pretty much everyone in the room, including Ghoul. The lights would have been beautiful if they hadn't been coming from a monster. They clearly were evil, though, because every time they hit Ghoul, she screamed in rage and redoubled her efforts to attack. Her attacks were useless, though. Each one warded away by the massive hunk of shield Beardywall wore. "Get him, Ghoul! You can do it!" I exclaimed in my mind, excited to see her change targets and knock Beardywall off his feet in frustration. Unfortunately, Greentooth finished his weird chanting, and another more powerful burst of green light surrounded Ghoul. Ghoul screamed, but her scream was abruptly cut off when Red Hood jumped in, slicing her throat. I wanted to shout a warning, but the instinct had other plans. Before I knew what was happening, I darted from my burning hiding place while the others were distracted. Beardywall was on the ground, unsteadily trying to get back to his feet and completely unguarded. The instinct guiding me, my shocker sparked with electric fury. I jabbed him in the back of his neck and heard a satisfying scream that was almost drowned out by the static zap from my shocker. He flopped back to the ground, listless, and I stared in wonder at my shocker. Had I made that terrible sound? I'd always called it a shocker, but never really knew why. Now I did. His body was twitching, but I didn't wait around to find out if he was broken or not. I hid before turning to view the results of my actions, instinct overpowering any desire to linger. Beardywall was down, either unconscious or broken. His body wasn't moving. A strange, murky angel was hovering near him, but it was barely visible. Transparent, like Bugbear and the others had been just before disappearing completely. Next to the short man's body was a little gravestone.
"Oh, son of a... Germ, you're supposed to focus on healing, not DPS. You let eggs die, you idiot," shouted the tallest one, the man with the silver metal clothes and the big hammer.
"Ah, shut up, Toby."
Greentooth's voice didn't match his stature. He sounded small, nasally, unnatural. How could such a weak sound come from such a mighty creature?
"Come on, I never get the chance to attack. Besides, he's fine. Right, Eggs?"
Greentooth trailed off, looking at Beardywall's body. I flashed yellow for a moment, anticipating the same horror I'd felt when they'd broken and disappeared my bugbears.
"Son of a bitch, Did he get hit that hard? My bad. Have him up in a second.
Greentooth responded with a flippant grin.
Wait, what? I thought. Where was the despair? Where was the mind-numbing chill? They'd broken my friends and I'd barely been able to move. The hurt was so raw and fresh it was all I could do not to run away screaming. I wanted them back. I wanted to hurt these people.
But breaking one of their friends didn't seem to have the same effect on them as it had on me. Were they just so cruel? Did they not care about their own? What did he mean by have him up?
Greentooth began chanting again, and a strange symbol appeared glowing on the ground in a circle around him. His words were low and guttural, but loud enough that I could hear that they were complete gibberish. But that gibberish was having a definite effect on the land around. My desire to jump out and shock him just like I had done to
Eggs?
To Beardywall warred with the instinct. Unlike Beardy, Greentooth was being watched by the others. I would be spotted, and then maybe broken just like my family if I tried now. I held back and watched as more glowing white lights appeared far above, along with tiny cherubim floating around in the vortex. Then I watched as the gravestone and the transparent angel disappeared, leaving a dazed but very much alive invader pulling himself to his feet.
Did she hit you that hard? Dav is doing just fine, and you're higher level than him. What the hell, Eggs?
Greentooth asked the newly revived creature.
Wasn't the ghoul at all. There's a assassin jellyfish or something in here. It insta-murked me.
I growled. How? How had it seen me? I'd been so fast and had never let myself be seen by it. I was behind it the whole time.
I didn't even see it, except in the replay,
Beardywall continued, oblivious to my quivering fear at these immortal monsters who could see while broken and be fixed by shiny lights.
I think that might be why this dungeon is so hard to reach. I think it's a secret mob.
Hey, little help with the pissed-off ghoul,
shouted the tall metal one who Ghoul had focused on after he'd shouted at her.
I'm off tank, you assholes.
Not questioning my first thought, I decided to refer to him as Tall Metal and hoped Ghoul would knock him away as he had done to Beardywall. No such luck, though. Tall Metal would let Ghoul attack him, which kept creating openings for the Red Hood to come in and stab her over and over again. Watching the girl move, I mentally renamed her Red Thorn. She was so fast, her hands moving with those daggers at speeds I couldn't follow.
Hey, did you change your name?
Greentooth asked Beardywall.
Ha, huh, that's great. Beardywall. I love it. Way better than that long-ass auto-generated bullshit you went with.
What the hell are you talking about? Also, watch Toby's health, yeah?
Beardywall exclaimed before diving back into melee range and bashing Ghoul with his shield. On the other side of Ghoul, Tall Metal was still letting Ghoul wail on him, striking with his sword occasionally, but mostly hiding behind his huge shield.
Newbie dungeon, eh?
Tall Metal shouted as he took blow after blow without falling, the green light from Greentooth restoring him before Ghoul could do any lasting damage.
Well, the first few floors were anyway,
Red Thorn exclaimed, dodging a wicked claw that might have raked her in two had it connected. Ghoul was fighting for her life, and these jerks were laughing about it. How could they be so cruel? I resolved to break them all. No, to kill them all. That was the word. That's what they had done to Bugbear and the rest. Killed them. Not broken. Killed. If I could take down Greentooth, then maybe the rest of them couldn't come back. Then maybe at least I could still have Mama Boss Bear with me. Oh, Bugbear, I thought with grief. Like a neon sign in front of me, my opening appeared. Greentooth was completely unwatched by his fellow monsters, and I dashed forward like lightning, Shocker bearing down on the green-skinned creature. I struck true, and while Greentooth screamed, he only slumped to one knee instead of falling to his death.
Was his green skin resistant to my shocker? He was much bigger than Beardy Wall, but he also seemed flimsier. I thought he would have gone down easier. I dove for the safety of the lamps to the sound of Green Tooth's agony.
Oh my God, get that freaking thing! Watch my back, Eggs. Low on mana from rezzing you,
he hissed as he was once more enveloped in green light. I waited patiently for another opening, but unfortunately, Ghoul didn't capitalize on Green Tooth's injury. Instead, she single-mindedly focused on bashing the metal plate out of Tall Metal's hands. For a brief moment, I was baffled by her complete unwillingness to change targets. Did Tall Metal's armor just make her mad or something? Could she not see that Green Tooth was vulnerable? I examined Tall Metal for a while, but almost leaped out of my sconce when a massive fireball hurled through the fighters and slammed into Ghoul. Ghoul's body was tossed around like a pebble and landed a few feet away, smoldering as she screamed in agony. I was horrified, but almost glad when she collapsed into silence, a charred ruin of her former self. She looked just like crumbling bones now, except her bones were black and burned. Her dark aura was gone, and the purple rags she wore were nothing but ash. No! I screamed mentally, careful not to speak aloud, lest they kill me too. No! I turned to the last member of the party. She'd been chanting for a long time, but hadn't had any pretty lights like Green Tooth. I'd ignored her. Stupid Gell. I should have known better. Green Tooth's chanting always did something. Why had I assumed hers wouldn't? Fire Tosser. She could throw fire with words. How?
Great shot, Ira,
Tall Metal shouted exuberantly.
So, maybe not such a newbie dungeon after all?
I mean, the thing was still pretty weak. Resistant to stabbing. Otherwise, I'd have taken it out easy, said Redthorn. But Toby's right.
Good shot, Ira. You didn't kill any of us this time.
Fire Tosser blushed, her pink cheeks turning red like mine did when Bugbear growled at me after singing to him. These monsters regularly kill each other? I thought frantically. What sort of devils were these?
Oh, shut up, puny human. If you were an elf, you'd be resistant to magic,
Fire Tosser replied imperiously, though there was an edge of laughter to the tone. The word struck me like a bolt. Human. Redthorn was a human. They weren't all, though. The names had come to me before, but I didn't want to apply more words that might make me sympathize with these murderers. Dwarf, orc, elf, human. All the same monster to me. But they talked. Even as they killed the only family I'd ever known, I yearned. Were they a family? Just like me and the bugbears and skeletons and ghoul? But even closer? Why had these horrible creatures been allowed conversation and laughter while I'd been living with nothing but growls for my entire life, starved for so much as a smile? I immediately felt guilty for the thought. I love my family, but they never seemed to love me back. I hated these invaders even more. Their easy conversation as they recuperated after killing another one of my family members just made me more and more resentful. I would kill them. When they fought Mama Boss Bear, I would be ready. I'd target Green Tooth first. Then they'd all die.
Chapter 4. Fighting the Tide.
Where the hell is it? Does it pop out of the ceiling or some shit?
Green Tooth exclaimed. I was quickly realizing that Green Tooth was by far the loudest of the invaders. Fire Tosser, by contrast, hardly ever spoke. Instead, the elf girl was content to be directed to throw fireballs at random spots in the ceiling over and over again, while I shuddered within the torch flames.
It isn't here anymore, Germ. Just get over it already,
Redthorn said snidely.
I bet whatever it is doesn't show itself until the boss room. Did anyone think that Ghoul was the boss of this dungeon? I kinda hoped,
Beardy Wall replied.
So no. Good. Then we continue on.
She flicked the air,
and my eyes widened as a strange transparent screen appeared in front of her. She poked at it a few times. To my shock, I could understand all of the symbols, despite having never seen them in my life. Status. Name. Red Thorn. Title. Rogue. Level. 11. Health. 257. Mana. 71. Characteristics. Strength. 17. Dexterity. 35. Vitality. 18. Wisdom. 7. Intelligence. 7. Charisma. 14. Luck. 12.
It's possible we may have found a deep dungeon, she continued, seemingly uncaring as she glanced over the phenomenon in front of her. Not likely, but possible, so let's... Hey, what the hell?
She pointed frantically at the screen.
My name changed. Red Thorn? Is that a feature of the dungeon? Hey, mine too. I'm Tall Metal, said the tall armored man as he, too, pulled up a strange window with statistics listed on it. This is freaking awesome. I wonder if it's permanent. I was kind of getting tired of being cut off your socks 97. To get a name like this, you'd have to have played in the beta.
Greentooth here, Greentooth said, and I did play in the beta. I like my name just fine. Does the dungeon just automatically do this?
Did I do that? I thought curiously. I'd given them those names, but only in my head. Maybe it reverts after we leave the dungeon. Perhaps these are just temporary monikers assigned when you come in?
Fire Tosser suggested, speaking for the first time.
Fire Tosser. It's like a kid saw what we did and decided to label us based solely on that. I'm Beardywall, the dwarf guffawed. Ah, a dungeon with a sense of humor. I love it.
I'm actually partial to mine, too, Red Thorn said.
Better than Andesare Lavanaya. Do you know how long it took me to find a name that didn't have numbers in it?
These creatures choose their own names? I thought, becoming interested in their conversation and hating myself for it. They just killed my family. The instinct insisted I try to kill them myself. They were interesting. And since when did any of your family ever care about you anyway? I shied away from the thought. They might not speak the same way I did. They might not do anything new. And maybe I was deluding myself about Bugbear's growls. But they were mine. All I'd ever known. I'd grown with them. So what if I'd grown beyond them?
Damn it, Jell. There's that arrogance again, I thought, frustrated with myself. Frustrated with my own interest in these creatures.
The kinship I felt just because I could actually understand them, while my family didn't have anything to say. The group began to gather up, collecting bits and pieces from... they were looting Ghoul's body. Disgusting creatures. Awful. Had they done that to Bugbear?
My desire to strike warred with both the instinct and common sense. If they could beat Ghoul, they'd have no problem chopping my gelatinous membrane into bits. I was fast, and I could be invisible. If I lost that, then I'd end up just like Ghoul, just like Bugbear, just gone. I shuddered. There weren't many rooms between Mama Boss Bear's throne room and the oval chamber where they'd killed Ghoul. They'd banished their screens during my bout of introspection and were now cautiously advancing. Their eyes were peeled, but I found that avoiding detection was surprisingly easy, fleeing behind them from flame to flame as the instinct directed. I silently prayed they would leave. Just go. Leave Mama Boss Bear and I alone. Hadn't they taken enough? But I knew they wouldn't, the greedy creatures. They'd stolen my family. Hell, they'd probably stolen the precious gift of conversation they'd displayed so readily. I wondered if I stopped them. Could I maybe take their ability to converse? I'd give it to Bug. But no, Bugbear was dead. I could only give it to Mama Boss Bear. If I could even figure out how to take it. I didn't think their language would be lying around on their corpses. If it was, though, I would take it.
I would take it and never give it back. They continued down through the last few corridors. Mama Boss Bear roared once more between the short journey, and I realized that she'd been angrily challenging the invaders ever since they'd entered. I scowled a little at the thought. Mama Boss Bear could have helped Ghoul. Why didn't she? That didn't matter, though. I focused, making certain none of the monsters spotted me as I dashed behind them. They kept shooting wary glances back, and there were a few close calls where my shocker might have been spotted entering or leaving the flames. They didn't attack, though, quietly conversing out of my hearing range. They laughed occasionally, merrily clawing their way through my home. I quaked in quiet anticipation as they neared Mama Boss Bear's lair, though. She would show them. Surely she would. Large stone doors opened, sliding seamlessly across the ornate flooring of the lower levels of the cave, revealing Mama Boss Bear and her throne. With all the changes happening today, it shouldn't have shocked me, but when she stood, her head rising halfway to the top of the cave's vaulted ceiling, I marveled. Mama Boss Bear was moving, and she was huge. I zipped past the open door and into another flame while the invaders were distracted by Mama Boss Bear's enormity. The instinct pushed me whenever I let it, so my mind was free to gape in wonder at her too.
"Newbie dungeon," Tall Metal said, eyes wide underneath that helmet he wore.
All right, I get it. I was wrong. Holy fuck, it's level 17, Red Thorn replied, her own eyes riveted on Dungeon Home's undisputed leader.
"Yes,"
I whispered, glad that they were afraid.
"Did you hear?"
Whatever Beardy Wall had been about to say was cut off entirely by Mama Boss Bear's roar. Rage filled her eyes and drool dripped from her mouth. If she weren't my family, even I might have been scared of her. She charged on all fours, barreling down the massive chamber towards the party of disturbed invaders. She had two weapons on her back, a halberd and a battle axe, but she didn't draw them. She didn't need them.
"Scatter!"
Red Thorn shouted, before dashing away from Mama Boss Bear, her speed incredible. The others were significantly less incredible. Fire Tosser screamed and hurled a fireball towards the ceiling, which missed Mama entirely in her mad flight. Tall Metal got mostly out of the way, but on her way past him, Mama's huge arm clipped his shield, sending him sprawling to the ground. Greentooth got out of the way in time, but Beardy Wall tripped and screamed as he was crushed under Mama Boss Bear's huge claws.
"Oh my God, again, Eggs?" Greentooth groaned.
I wouldn't get a better chance. I blasted from my hiding place, a tongue of flame licking the air behind me as electricity pulsed between the small tendrils that made up my shocker. I heard a yelp of warning from Redthorn, but she was too slow to warn Greentooth. I caught him completely unaware and stung him right between his armor and skull. He flopped to the ground, clawing gingerly at his neck. A sizzling electrical burn scalded into his green skin. The scream drew Mama Boss Bear's attention. Perfect.
"It's that damn jellyfish. It got germ," Red Thorn shouted. "Toby, voke it. Voke the little monster."
Tall Metal was still on the ground, dazed. He was trying to get back to his feet, but he was too slow. Mama Boss Bear was closing in on Greentooth, drawing the huge halberd off her back. I yelped as a blade just missed slicing through my membrane and darted back into the fire, then flashed as fast as I could to the next and the next, then back. The flame from each of the torches danced in wide arcs, obscuring which torch I was hiding in. I didn't know I could do that, I thought. Greentooth was chanting, but he kept twitching, lingering damage from my shock interrupting his ability to speak. I saw his eyes go wide as Mama Boss Bear swung. That was all it took. The halberd cleaved Greentooth's belly, slicing his robes and spraying Mama Boss Bear with his blood. He toppled backward, and Mama stomped on him with her colossal foot. One invader down. No, two. Beardy Wall had died again from being trampled.
Shit! Shit! This is a freaking wash! Healers down!
Redthorn called out, annoyed.
Annoyed, not afraid.
Not at all what she should be.
I couldn't figure it out. They were facing certain defeat, probably death. The person who could bring them back to life was now gone. I could see the transparent angel and the stone that marked where he'd died. His body was already disappearing, just like Bugbear. But they weren't reacting like it mattered. Instead, they were just annoyed, like this was a minor inconvenience. Somehow that made me even angrier.
Don't give up yet, Red. We can take it.
Not with that damn assassin jellyfish striking when we don't expect it, Ira. Use water or ice magic on the torches. It's hiding in them.
I know,
Fire Tosser shouted indignantly, obviously lying.
Wait, water magic?
She lifted her hands and began to speak in a soft monotone, the same gibberish that Greentooth had used.
Oh, no, you don't, I thought. This time when I fled the flames, I did so directly at her. She'd shown she would panic at a head-on attack when Mama Boss Bear had charged her. Something about realizing this made the instinct scream that I should take advantage. Sure enough, she squealed and lost focus of her spell when she saw me coming. She'd apparently said enough words in that other language, though, because her flailing sent a jet of ice from her outstretched hand. The bolt missed me, but by luck managed to hit the torch I'd just vacated, snuffing it out with a hiss of smoke. I abandoned my attack, rushing for the nearest torch and following the instinct as I flitted between them, obscuring which one I actually resided in again. Fire Tosser didn't stop, though. She recovered and again began chanting, this time staring at one of the torches on the far side of the room. Oh, no, I thought, realizing that as long as Fire Tosser could toss water, too, she could whittle away at my hiding places. Well, not all of them. I could turn invisible, but that went against the instinct. But I glow, I thought with rising panic. If I couldn't go invisible, I'd be unable to hide in the darkness. Was it worth it to die to follow the instinct? I decided at that moment that it was. It definitely was. I did not want to be like these people. They had ignored their instinct. I didn't think they could even hear it anymore. I would follow my instinct, and if I was broken, killed, at least I might go to the same place Bugbear had gone. Fortunately, that didn't seem likely today. Tall Metal had managed to stand and had drawn Mama Boss Bear's attention away from Beardy Wall's corpse, but unlike Ghoul, Mama was strong. Each swipe with her claw sent Tall Metal sprawling. Only Red Thorn remained unhurt. She danced and dodged between Mama's cursory strikes faster than I could believe. As active as she seemed to be, though, peppering Mama with thin stabs that didn't seem to do anything, it wasn't enough to distract her from Tall Metal. The man was flagging. His shield looked battered, and one of the straps that held it to his arm was broken. When he was dead, then Mama could bring her full attention to bear on Red Thorn. Then even she would fall. So my job, obviously, was to keep Fire Tosser from throwing any more fire. Red Thorn made it her mission to hover near the spellcaster, flipping between distracting Mama from Tall Metal and keeping me from taking out the mage. This allowed Fire Tosser to throw ice bolt after ice bolt at my diminishing torches. That was okay, though. If I couldn't get to one of them, I circled the room, taking longer and riskier runs to get into a good spot to ambush Tall Metal, who'd been left out of position while the thorn kept protecting Fire Tosser. Mama Boss Bear didn't even seem tired as she struck the tall, armored man over and over again, never allowing him the opportunity to do anything but block with his crumbling shield.
"Toby, watch out!"
Red Thorn cried, in seemingly the same moment as I saw a perfect opening. Already committed, I dashed forward towards the metal man, hoping to catch his hand or neck with my shocker. As if anticipating my move, he grinned and held up his hand. I tried to change course, but moved far too slowly. A bright flash blasted out from his gauntlet, blinding me. I stabbed my shocker wildly where I thought he'd been standing, but caught only air. I panicked, but the instinct protected me,
taking over my movements and guiding me while I was lost. I flailed, and my body undulated through the air in a mad tumble that the instinct insisted upon. Fortunately, if attacks came while I was blinded, I didn't feel them. I didn't have eyes in the same way as the bugbears, yet I could see. I could be blinded. How did that even make sense? I blinked metaphorically as my vision slowly recovered and realized I had reached the safety of one of the torches. Mama Boss Bear had distracted all three of the remaining invaders to cover my escape. Tall Metal stood in a corner of the chamber, valiantly standing between Mama Boss Bear and his companion Fire Tosser. Red Thorn was constantly dancing around the battlefield, but she seemed unable or unwilling to realize that her strikes were doing nothing to Mama Boss Bear. Fire Tosser had extinguished almost half the torches in the room while I'd been blinded, and they fought on the other side of the room, far from any of the still burning ones. Unfortunately, I couldn't attack any of them with any chance of ambushing them. Unless I break the instinct again, I thought. But why? I didn't feel in danger anymore. The invaders were faltering, breaking like they'd broken my family, breaking like the instinct they either ignored or never had, breaking like the rules. I just wanted things to go back. I didn't want all this excitement. I didn't want invaders. I didn't want Mama Boss Bear angry and frothing. I wanted her on her throne like she'd always been. I wanted to fool myself into believing Bugbear's growls were at me and not part of the cycle again. I didn't want this. Just go away, I whispered, feeling guilty. Leave us alone.
Huh?
Red Thorn paused, turning back to look at me. That split second of distraction allowed Mama Boss Bear to rake her claws across Thorn's back. The human didn't scream, but tumbled to the floor, her leather armor taking the brunt of the strike. She rolled along the ground, seemingly uninjured, and was back on her feet in moments, snarling in my direction.
Hey, just let it kill you. I'll meet you at respawn. The bear's no threat to me, but I can't hurt it. I'm going to try to take down that damn jellyfish.
The bear will kill you while you're hunting it, Tall Metal yelled over the clang of claw on shield.
Goodness, how was that shield still functional? I thought, staring at the scrap of metal that had once glistened with beauty. Now it only glistened with bloody gouges, more chunks cut out of it than there was metal remaining.
Then if you distract it, your death won't be in vain, you putz.
Ha, putz.
I smiled. Then I yearned. Would I ever get to talk with anyone like that? Would I ever get to joke? To laugh? The bugbears never showed any inclination of speaking back to me, but they were my family, weren't they? And Mama Boss Bear was the last of my family.
I shoved down the longing and followed the instinct. Tall Metal screamed as he accidentally stepped into the way of one of Fire Tosser's fireballs. Mama Boss Bear tore through the broken man, aiming to sink her halberd or her claw into Fire Tosser's fragile flesh. The instinct pushed me, and I blurred forward. Fire Tosser was distracted. She was wide open, but Boss Bear might get hurt attacking her. I had to stop her.
Ha! Got you!
I only had a moment to turn in horror before I saw the edge of a knife gleaming in the torchlight. I screamed. Agony ripped through my body as the knife impaled me straight through my membrane. I gaped as it took me with it and pinned me to the wall. I struggled, but that only made my body burn where the knife was stabbing me. Liquid was leaking out of me. It hurt. I whimpered.
Yes, I got it!
Red Thorn exclaimed gleefully, grinning at me. It hurt so bad.
Oh, still alive?
The voice was filled with a delighted glee. She enjoyed this. Enjoyed hurting me.
We'll fix that.
I never knew that words could be so terrifying. Another blade flashed from her outstretched hand. The pain ended.
Chapter 5.
all askew. I didn't wake up. I didn't come alive. It was more like I was suddenly aware that I was doing something, but forgot exactly what. The halls of Dungeon Home were tranquil. The wall torches burned with a gentle blue light. I floated on the second floor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.